Wetware Media presents Paradigm Shift, Consciousness, Meditation, and Quantum Physics, a conversation with Samuel Avery, author of the audiobook, The Buddha and the Quantum, Hearing the Voice of Every Cell. This recording is copyright 2011 by Wetware Media.
What I'm trying to do here with the Buddha and the Quantum is to combine two very disparate fields, namely meditation and physics, which are miles apart, or poles apart. Most people would think of meditation as the ultimate subjective experience, where a person is looking within and trying to de-emphasize the physical world, trying to look past the common everyday experiences that we have in our lives. And where physics, on the other hand, is the ultimate objective experience, where physicists are not interested in consciousness. They're not interested in what's going on within. They want to study the external world with no, and they think they're doing this without any involvement in conscious experience. So I'm trying to take these two polar opposites and develop a connection between them, which is non-dualistic, that is, a single understanding of reality that is not either religion or science, or just the spiritual and not the physical, or just the physical and not the spiritual. These two are deeply connected. And my thesis is that something that the Buddha discovered over 2,000 years ago, deep inside the human mind, and called the kalapa, or the subtle sensation, is the same thing that modern science discovered a little over 100 years ago and called the quantum. What the Buddha considered to be a fundamental unit of consciousness is the same thing that Max Planck discovered in the year 1900 and called a fundamental unit of energy. Physics and science in general assumes that consciousness is something inside of space and time. Where what I'm trying to do here is to say that space and time are structures of consciousness. They help us put together what we experience. They help us coordinate what we see with what we feel and what we smell and taste and hear. So that space and time, rather than being an external structure of the universe, is in fact an internal structure of consciousness. And once we're able to make that paradigm shift, and that's a big shift to make, but once we're able to do that, all of a sudden, a lot of the problems that we've been experiencing in quantum physics and in relativity theory begin to make sense, and we can put the pieces together in a different way. So what I'm doing is I'm not changing what we see. I'm not changing what we experience. I'm just changing the point of view from which we experience it. It's in many ways, it's analogous to the paradigm shift that happened at the time of Copernicus back in the 1500s, in which Copernicus didn't change anything about what we saw when we looked at the sky. He just had a better way of understanding it and explaining it. And it's still possible, you can still go outside on a starry night and you can still imagine the Earth in the center of the universe. But as you look more deeply into how the planets move, for instance, it just doesn't make any sense until you realize that the Earth is moving. And that's a huge jump to take, an intellectual jump to take, because you know it seems so commonsensical that the Earth was at the center of the universe. But you have to take that jump in order to understand what science was beginning to tell us about where our place was in the universe. Physics has been trying to tell us something for over 100 years, And we can't quite hear it because of the assumptions we make about the relationship between the physical world and consciousness. We're trying to actually not remove consciousness from space and time, because it's already removed as far as I'm concerned. It's just a matter of seeing space and time within consciousness and understanding it as a fundamental structure of consciousness. And we can do that. It's possible to see that. And the way I have discovered to see that, to experience it directly, is through meditation. To take the Buddha's approach and see the same, what he was talking about, see the same things that he was talking about, and then go back and look at physics, what physics is trying to tell us. Neither one is right or wrong. It's just a matter of taking this vast knowledge we've accumulated in the West and look at the same thing from a different point of view, where not only is space and time within consciousness, but also we have to take another look at what consciousness is. In the West, we tend to assume that consciousness is the same thing as self. We tend to think, well, that's, you know, what I'm feeling now is my leg, or I'm having my thought or my idea, and we're unable to detach our sense of self from what we experience. And to understand what I'm trying to say, you have to at least intellectually understand that self and consciousness are not the same thing. And if they are, everything I'm saying is wrong. Science does not like to talk about anything that's not verifiable, that's not measurable and verifiable. And that's fine, that's good, because that keeps science objective and keeps it a study of a particular structure of consciousness, but not the whole thing. See, that's what I'm getting at, is in the West, we tend to think that to be real, something has to be in space and time. It has to be perceptual. It has to be something that's verifiable. Whereas there's a lot of experience that we all know. There's a lot of experience that is not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.